Peter Leonard.
Welcome, Peter. Peter.
It's on Testify. We heard his testimony, well, a brief 10 minutes a couple of weeks ago from today when we're recording this. And so it's good to get you here now, fresh, and sharing. Been on the Gold Coast since 2003.
Yep.
Before.
Originally from Sydney.
Originally
from Victoria.
So. Correct. Would you classify yourself as a Victorian or a Queenslander?
A Queenslander.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
Come on. Well, that's an interesting question. Who do you support in the Origin?
What's that?
Get out.
Right. AFL. So you support the Suns?
Who are they? Yes.
All right, in the lawn we're bowls, who do you...
We're playing...
Tugan.
Aussie rules.
Yeah, actually, do you watch rugby, AFL, NRL, Union? What do you watch anything?
No.
Actually?
Actually don't.
You don't, and you don't even watch The Origin?
No.
Don't care. Wow.
Ask your dad about the men's group I went to one time, and I thought it was the men's group, and they're all sitting around watching footy. Oh. And I'm looking, going, they're all looking at the screen. I go, maybe they're going to turn it off soon. And they're having communion, and I'm like, and their eyes are open watching the footy. I'm like, is this a footy night?
These guys legit, yeah.
And
that was the State of Origin night, it would have been.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He goes, nah, this was Wednesday night.
Yeah.
I went around for a Bible study. Last Wednesday, gone.
No, Wednesday night is the only night Origin's on. So that would have been a while ago.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I remember last year or whenever it was they had it on, they finally had it on a Sunday or something, didn't they?
This was definitely Wednesday.
Yeah.
Okay, so it would have been 2 or 3 years ago.
Anyway.
So they got, you know, the crackers and dips and drinks, and I'm like, this is different to the other nights. There's a lot of people running around the football field there.
Yes.
I think I might have come to the wrong night. Oh, we forgot to text you.
Yeah. What does this have to do with Jesus? Oh, if you watch long enough, one of the football players will give thanks to God. After he tries, he points his finger in the air and looks up. It's a Christian experience. Yeah. Same thing happens with the UFC. It's awesome. Oh. They're all Christians. Wow. It's like to thank God for helping me knock that guy out.
Just so you know, he's not meaning that all Christians yet. No.
Oh, maybe that. No. Figure it out for yourself.
No. So surfing's your sort of outlet.
Yeah.
Your passion.
Yep.
You did that in Victoria as well?
Yeah, I've done it all my life.
Okay.
It's sort of like, it's a sport, healthy, it's good, reflective, you get out in the water and think.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's true, eh?
Social.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot of aspects to it.
You love it?
Yeah. I don't live for it.
No.
But, yeah, I've done it all my life and travelled surfing and enjoyed it. But not competitive. I'm not a competitive
surfer. Yeah.
No.
Big waves? You're not a big wave guy either?
Yeah, I've handled some pretty big ones.
Oh, okay. But you don't go on the hunt for a big wave?
Used to, not now. Okay. No.
Where have you surfed overseas?
Sumatra.
Yeah.
Oh. In Indonesia.
Yeah.
Bali.
Nusa Lambongan.
No, I went further on the west coast, up and down.
Away from the crowds.
Yeah, and out off outer islands off Sumatra.
Oh, man. It gets big there, eh?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. What's the biggest you've surfed there?
I didn't surf the big waves. We got there and it was, they say it was 6 or 7 times overhead, which was, they said it was an 18-foot swell. So when we went there, we were in a big 75-foot steel boat that took us to all these nice little corners where the swell would just wrap in.
Wow.
Mm.
The benefit about that, for people who don't know, surfing a spot like that, is you can surf bigger than what you're used to because it's easier to get out of the way of the waves. You can just get out into a channel where the waves aren't breaking, so it's a little bit less risky, eh?
Where?
Huh?
Where's that?
Surfing reef breaks.
No, they're more risky.
Not if you can surf bigger. Do you not think it's safer?
No.
I'm not talking about hitting your head on the reef or that.
It's faster. It moves a lot quicker. And it is very shallow. And, yeah, you can go and sit in the channel if you like and be a boat. But when the waves come through, you're not going to get in that channel. Wow. Not if you're in the area where the waves are.
No, that's what I'm saying. But you can sit in the channel, build your confidence up. It's not like surfing, you know, if it's 3 meters at the beach, you've got to get through those waves
to get out. Yeah, yeah.
It's pretty physical. It's dangerous. But you rock up to a reef break on a boat. You can sit in the channel till you build your confidence up. You can cruise over, paddle onto a wave, and then catch that wave and get back out to the channel quickly and you're safe again. It's not like that on a beach break. It's pretty hectic, yeah.
Yeah.
You catch a wave, you've got 10 waves behind that are coming at you. That's my experience.
I'm out of my league here.
I could talk about surfing all day.
I'm out of my league.
It's scary.
Yeah. Oh, no doubt. It's not simple. It's still scary, but yeah.
Anyway. Any close calls?
Surfing? Many close calls.
Wow. Okay.
Blacking out.
What?
Yeah, yeah. Be held down on big waves and black out. And then you just got to let go. And just float to the surface.
That's how people die. That's hectic.
Yeah. Because you don't know which way's up or down sometimes. So sometimes guys are swimming what they think to the surface and they're going down, they hit the bottom, then they turn around and come back up again.
Wow.
Yeah.
You like surfing in Queensland as opposed to New South Wales and Victoria?
Victoria is really good because it's
okay.
It's a lot more remote and you get a lot bigger waves at times. Okay.
Just
Queensland's
cold.
A lot warmer.
Mm.
Yeah, okay.
And it's cleaner. It looks cleaner and the waves are just it's like a better texture.
Wow. There you go. Surfing's a bit of a enjoyment for you.
It's an outlet. It's enjoyment. It's fitness.
Yep.
Not as much as I'd like.
Yeah.
Because it depends on the seasons we get.
Sure. Mm. And you're a Sparky by trade.
Yes.
Been doing that for a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not by choice.
A few blackouts there as well.
it's more of a tent maker type of thing. It's provision.
Yeah, mm. sure. And did you sort of fall into that? I'll just be a Sparky or something you always.
I think my dad sort of gave me the option of plumbing or Sparky.
Okay.
And I didn't like to sort of work with the stuff that plumbers work with, so. I figured it's going to be a bit cleaner being an electrician.
Yeah.
He lined me up with a job. Back in those days, it was pretty easy to get apprenticeships.
Wow.
And off I went, yeah.
And 40 years later, you're still doing it.
Yeah, I'm sure they didn't think I'd ever make it when I was first starting back then.
Yeah. So, any shark attacks surfing?
No, I've had some encounters, but no attacks.
And shocks sparking?
Plenty of shocks.
Plenty of shocks. Yeah. Worst one that you can remember?
Oh, I vaguely remember in my apprenticeship days playing with a three-phase 440 volt welding outlet. And I did remember getting thrown across. Well, wow. I can't remember getting thrown across, but I picked myself up and realised I had been thrown across. Yeah, but I was still alive, so that was good.
Wow. How far did it throw you?
I don't know. It might have been about 6 metres or something.
Oh, wow. My
I'm not sure by the time I picked myself up. It's so vague back then. We're talking the 70s.
Sure.
Can you remember the 70s?
No, I was born in the 70s.
I can't remember the 70s.
I was 74, baby, mate.
I wasn't even a thought.
Well, that's probably when it happened. No. It was
Marshall's born.
It would have been 76. From 76 on.
Okay.
Yeah,
yeah, I was two.
There we go. One and a half.
So when were you born? What year? 60?
Just after the Second World War. Well, 10 years after.
Oh, 58.
Yeah.
Well, I think you're doing great, man. That's awesome.
Surfing. Keeps you young.
Surfing. Sparking.
Yeah.
Loving Jesus.
Mm.
You always had a relationship with the Lord?
No.
Oh, by the way, it's great to have Peter on with us, testify. So you weren't brought up in the church or walking with God?
It was really weird because back in those days, parents would just send their kids to Sunday school.
Okay.
At the local Church of England, High Church of England, Presbyterian, off you go.
In Victoria, in Melbourne.
Yeah, you just go. So my sister and I went to Sunday school.
Walk or picked up or dropped off?
We would have been dropped off and picked up again. So not that I can remember anything of it, but I know where we went. And then years later I went to an Olympic gym at the same place. And every time we go to the gym, they'd be saying, the instructor would say the Lord's Prayer. And I'm like, what do they say this every time for? You'd have to say it and be like, you know, a routine.
You get the discount.
I didn't join the dots that it was actually, must have been connected to the church.
Yeah.
Right.
So I was a bit thick. I never got the dots all the way
right,
through.
Right.
And then went to, I often went to a boys' club, which was with the Brethren Church. And that was an interesting thing because you had a lot of men running a group for boys.
How old were you then?
Oh, from primary school up into my secondary years at some point. I can't remember when I stopped.
Okay, yeah.
But you go along there and you might have a trade night where they teach you how to change a washer on a tap.
Oh, that's awesome.
It was all sorts of little skills. But then...
How awesome was that?
Yeah, so
it was pretty interesting, actually. And then we, of course, had inter-clubs, swimming, sports, athletics. But the highlights were that have boxing nights and wrestling nights. So you'd have to work your way up. So if you knocked out the next guy, you had to go to the next... So it was like, what do they call that? Round robin something? Anyway.
Yeah, yeah, round,
and you work,
round
and then
robin.
Finally,
K1.
Finally you're up against the guy who's already training in karate or something. It's like, how did I get up here? And I think these guys loved beating the snot out of me because I was just the kid down the road and they were all the group. And I think years later they regretted it, but when I became a Christian.
Yeah.
we'd go away on camps, motorbikes, go-karts. It was pretty cool.
All put on by a church or group.
Yeah.
Is this the Benevolence Society?
No, the Brethren Society. It was the Brethren Church. And they had a lot of tradies, farmers. At that point, they used to run all the Christian youth camps.
Yeah.
So they had all that, so we'd go to all those. So it was pretty cool.
That's actually awesome.
Yeah. So, and again, I'd hear people give their testimony.
Wow.
And I go, what the heck are they talking about?
Mm.
You know, I missed it again. So I never could remember the testimony, just the fact that they were giving their testimony.
Right.
And it was like...
And it sort of didn't relate to you?
I never joined the dots.
Wow.
And so there was that. And then I had... It was like we lived in Ireland. So we had the Catholics down one end and the Protestants down the other of our street. And then on what we call Cracker Night, when you... You know, what do they call that with all the fireworks?
Guy Fawkes in New
they
Zealand.
If that's 4th of July in America or whatever.
Whatever it is, but we have the cracker night.
November.
So this is when you could buy the big crackers and stuff.
Yeah.
And sorry, I got an itchy nose. and so the Protestants, who's one of the dads was a plumber, we'd get all the pipes and we'd load them full of berries and rocks and then we'd fire it at the Catholics. So this is the sort of environment I grew up in. So I had a street full of Catholics and Protestants, one end, one at the other. So it was like I was in the middle of North and Southern Ireland or something, you know. So,
Dublin.
And then it was quite a strong Catholic area. And
then rocks and berries.
Yeah, they went well. And
so they get stoned and painted at the same time.
Yeah.
That's like the spud gun, eh? The big pipe.
They were pipes with gunpowder in them. So they're pretty much little cannons, yeah. Yeah.
Anyone ever get hurt?
Yeah. Of course they did. Yeah.
Jeez.
Yeah. It was fun.
Wow.
So
it was fun.
And then, so they were the guys that I sort of associated with when I was younger. And we built mini bikes and.
Serving Jesus is awesome.
Yeah. I killed a kid. It was sick.
And then we'd be racing homemade motorbikes along the street and.
What town is this in?
And then we had paddocks around where we lived, and so we'd have races. And then when these particular guys I was with didn't want other people to ride in there, they would dig holes and put spikes in holes and cover it up with paper and sprinkle stuff across the top. So the next guys would come along, not meant to go there, we'd go down the ditch and get spiked. So it had a combination of different cultures in there.
This is hectic. What town is this in?
This is in Melbourne. Yeah.
Like what town?
It's called Murrumbeena, which is Aboriginal for land of many frogs.
Jeez, man, that sounds hectic.
That's incredible.
It was a really cool city, and then apparently it's one of the most dangerous places to live now in Melbourne, which I didn't know.
It sounds like it's held on to that.
Yeah.
If only you guys had GoPros back then. You'd have some sick footage to look at.
Yeah. We had Super 8s.
You had what?
Super 8s, movie cameras. Yeah.
Before my time.
Yeah, before my time too.
Really? Okay.
I heard.
Yeah, I've always pretty much had one of these.
Okay.
No, not really. When I was about 12, 13, cameras on phones.
Wow.
Anyway, that's brutal.
So
there's been this connection with the church.
Oh, yeah.
From when you were a kid.
Well, then I lived some pretty wild teen years. After coming out.
Stuff wasn't wild enough.
Coming out, that's the date thing. And so we grew up in an area where all the parties we go to, skinheads would rock up in taxis and it'd all be on. And
yeah, wow. Come on.
And then, you know, you'd be at a party and someone would say, Chopper Reed's coming tonight, Chopper Reed. Because I grew up in a big ethnic area and the second biggest Greek population outside of Athens. So they all had accents. And Chopper Reed's coming tonight. And it's like, and that wasn't my Kiwi accent either. Oh.
By Chopper Reed, do they mean the skinheads?
No, you haven't heard the story of Chopper Reed? No.
I know Chopper Reed.
Yeah.
No, so but I'm just saying, don't tell me you were actually at a party that Chopper Reed rocked up to.
No, he never did, but we're always worried about he would because people were that I was at the party with were associated with all these sorts of people.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, yeah.
No. I'm going to say this publicly. I love Chopper Reed.
You've actually got someone in chapel who used to work in his bar.
Wow.
Where he used to
work. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Anyway.
Have you seen the movie?
I don't watch movies like that.
No. It's Australian history, mate. Oh. It's a it's a documentary.
Oh, okay.
Kind of.
Good.
No. Of violence.
Wow. So that's
So anyway, yeah. So I grew through that era and it was the '70s. So it was like the Bee Gees, it was John Travolta, Saturday Night Fever, all that stuff.
Sick.
So it was pretty cool. I used to light up the dance floor. You know, there's
dance floors
that light up, you know, and all that. So I'd be out there in the middle and they clear the floor for me. And people don't believe me, but I'll never do it again. But
could you if you wanted to?
No, I wouldn't. I couldn't.
You could.
See, how awesome would a camera be back then?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Have you got any of the...
Not of that.
Wow. Okay.
Surfing big waves, but not of that.
Yeah.
And then, of course, I was very good at dating. But not make it last.
Right.
So this is. I say that not in the wrong way. I say it in the fact that then I started to date girls who were from Christian families, and I didn't know.
Mm.
Right.
I think maybe they were sort of on the edge.
Right.
But there was something about them that was different to all the other girls. So when I look back, I can see God was like starting to move things into place. Now
that's cool.
I never ended up in any long-term relationships with them, but. They were different. Everything was different when you are going out with someone who's
got a foundation
or their
of faith.
Family are. Because right. I remember going to a 21st birthday of one of my friends who lived up the road who shot the cannons. And I had to apologize to this girl because I took her to her. I said, look, I'm sorry, these people are a little bit religious. And, you know, she goes, oh, no, that's okay, my parents are. I'm like, wow, okay. And then so this sort of conversation would come up. Still not joining the dots. I'm talking, I'm now like 20 and I'm still not joining the dots. And then I think that's, when I look back, I wasn't looking for God, but he was definitely looking for me.
Mm. Wow, I love that.
I know that. I know it for some weird reason, which I keep asking 40 years later, he's called me for a purpose and I'm still... Maybe it's just a walk with him daily. I don't know. But he definitely called me because still weren't joining the dots. And in my testimony, I talked about how I used to ride enduro through the mountains. That was fantastic. We're talking about, you don't have mobile phones, so you get lost or broken. You're out there and they find you years later as a skeleton under your motorbike. So I'd be in the bush and, you know, up to the handlebars in mud, through rivers. Just
yeah,
it was so good. I can smell the smell now. It was so good.
That's awesome.
In the mountains of Victoria. And when I came out of I've shared this in my testimony. When I came out of the mountain and it was like a grassy knoll overlooking the ocean, it was spectacular. It was just lush. It's like, and I can still see it today. And when I stopped and I looked out of that ocean, it was like this presence of God. That's all I can explain. I dropped my helmet to the ground and I'm sure there was tears coming out. I said, God, I've got to get to know you.
Wow.
And I was sort of like...
How old were you then?
I would have been 21 then. And so I was like dumbfounded. I'm by myself. I'm not with anyone. And I had this encounter. And then after that point, I start to meet people. I got removed from the job I was...
Just go back there... Yep. Like again, so you're doing this enduro thing.
Yeah.
And you're just cracking along on this by yourself.
Yeah.
And you come through this opening.
Yep. Come out of the...
And you're just like, God.
Yeah. It was like a presence. It was not a scary presence.
No.
It was like I've been after you. I'm like, when I think back.
But it was quite real. It was real.
It was very real.
I mean, I'm feeling it.
And you weren't in need of anything. You're not going through a tough time. You're not asking for anything.
I think all teens are searching.
Right.
Yeah.
I think everyone's searching.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And so at that moment, a series of events started to happen where I'd meet people, run across people. The guys that I grew up with the Cannons, they were also surfers, and they just happened to be down that way at Easter of 1980 and down the west coast of Victoria, and I met up with them, and it was sort of the rough ones who were still part of that Christian community. They'd grown up with the families that I was connecting with, which was interesting for them and for me. And then there was little things. I was still getting fed, like a little bird getting fed bits and pieces.
Mm.
And so from that point on, when I said, God, I've got to get to know you, I started to recluse a bit. I had a cabin down the coast, and so I'd have my motorbike, surfboards, and just chill out and listen to music. And I'd stopped a lot of things I was doing. So I'd stopped, not that I was heavily into drugs, but I'd stopped some of the stuff I was doing, right, and even drinking and even chasing relationships. I just wanted to just be just by myself, reclusing. And so then I worked for a company, and they had to get rid of me in my third year. So in my fourth year, I went and worked with someone else as an apprentice. And somehow, I don't know even if they liked me. So they I had a number of people dislike me. And so they tipped me out to work with another guy. And then he happened to be a Christian. So he was just there with me. And eventually I ended up working for him when I became a tradesman shortly later. I was able to subcontract to him for years. And that was great. He thought I was great. And so finally someone's appreciating what I'm doing. But he happened to be a Christian too. And he did have a missionary work with us as a labourer one or two days there. And I can remember him saying, you know, are you going to heaven? I go, yeah, I'm going to heaven. He goes, are you sure of that? I said, well, yeah, I think I am. And then he started to explain a little bit more about it. And so that got me thinking as well. So they would flick me tapes. Back then they had tapes. I don't know if you're aware of what a tape is.
You
put it into your car and it'd spin around and get caught and all the tape, and you have to pull it all out of your
tape. You have to unwind it to get back to this. I mean, rewind it to get back to the start.
That too. But this is where I was listening. I'd said in my testimony how I was in buying new snow skis because I used to do snow skiing as well. So I was decking myself out for the season, driving home in my nice 5-litre V8.
That
was nice. And then coming back and listening to this guy who I think he was a gang leader, or at least he was in a gang. I found out later he was a major civil rights preacher in America, Tom Skinner. And he gave his testimony. He said, if God can do it for me, he can do it for you. And so at that point, I said, God, do it. I don't know what it is, but do it. So, and that's, again, the tears came, and that's where I think that's probably where I really stepped over the line and committed myself.
So how old were you then?
21. This was all in a matter of weeks or...
From the encounter in the forest.
From the encounter, yeah. Yeah, but like I wasn't seeking him. He was pursued seeking you. Me.
Yeah. Putting people in your path and doing things and
Yeah.
I love that.
And did anything significant happen there? It was just still continually a few things happening.
I walked into the Brethren. First of all, I walked into a little church down the coast because I was surfing in Phillip Island in Victoria, and I walked into a little church on the mainland, and it was like a farming district. I just walked in, hardly anyone there, and I just sat in there in the church and got to know the people there. And there was an organisation, I don't even know if they're still around, God Squad, the bikers.
Yeah, they're still around. They're okay. On the coast. I know a couple guys in the God Squad.
So we're talking back in early 80s. The founders...
They were around then.
Yeah. And there was another... there was that and Truth and Liberation, which was all like a big ministry back then to people, to the... to the Outlaws type of thing. And the parents of one of the founder of it were in this church in this little country town.
Yes.
I'm talking like farm, like a little church and a farm. And I walked in and they just chatted with me, and that was my first encounter with church. I'd actually been surfing at Phillip Island that day, and I'd got a really good wave and come out of the wave, and this guy goes, "Hey man, that was a great wave." And I'm like, my wetsuit had peeled down off me, so he helped me peel it back up when I got a, because I'd gone through a tube in the wave and it ripped it off me. And I felt, God, I've got to learn how to reach these guys. These guys need to know what I know. And so, because there was no evangelism back then with surfers back then, not that I knew of.
Mm.
And so then I went to this farm, and then from that I came back to Melbourne where my parents lived, and I went to the little Brethren church where I'd gone to the boys' club and everything. Well, I just walked in the door on a Sunday morning, and here I was. And they're like, here's that guy down the road who's caught between the Catholics and the Protestants, and here he is. And, wow, they're just like, I told them that I'd become a Christian. And they were almost speechless. And so, and there were all the guys that through the round robin of boxing and wrestling who'd beaten the snot out of me. Suddenly I'm in their church. I'm back. And this is the very church where the boys' club was.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And then from that point on, got together with these guys and we started an organisation to reach surfers. And then it's... Since then, it's gone international, but I've got nothing to do with it now.
That's awesome. Mm. What's the name of the organisation now? Do you know?
Yeah, it's Christian Surfers.
Oh, no way. Yeah. Is that where the Surfers Bible came from?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. A lot of things have come from that.
You know what's crazy about that is the guys that I hung out with when I first got saved were all Christian surfers.
Yep.
They started a surf brand called Saved. These are all amazing dudes that doing a similar ministry on the coast. Some of them are like ex-pros. Some of these dudes grew up with like Mick Fanning and Mick Fanning's brother. And they all had, like they used to hand out the Surfers Bible. One of the first Bibles I got was like the Surfers Bible. And that all started in Victoria, in Melbourne.
Well, we started the Victorian group, and at the same time, all over Australia, there was other groups either started or starting or started after that. So probably Sydney was one of the oldest ones, and they produced the Bible with the Bible Society. So we had the Victorian group. There were three groups there or four groups there. And so we ran a lot of events there and had an outreach centre and did a lot of things, a lot of stuff. And
so this was sort of 22 to what?
Probably 21. I started open air preaching when I was 6 months saved.
Wow.
No way.
Yeah. So because so getting with these Brethren guys who really weren't involved with evangelism I was sort of put a shockwave through the place, and they thought, well, let's get together and let's form a group.
Sparked it up.
Yeah, Sparky. Put a bit of
sparked it up, right. I said, okay, boys, tonight we're going pub evangelism. So I took the Brethren boys to the pub to evangelise.
Well, what gave you this idea to do that? Like, why were you like, I can do this?
The idea just came. Like, why not? So I was, you've got to remember, I was saved. And so when I got saved, I think it was quite an interesting transformation, because I went from feeling like I was just in no man's land to suddenly I realised that, well, there's a whole world here that I didn't know about.
That's crazy. So you started with pub evangelism.
We did do that. We did do a lot of outreaches in open air as well, in camping grounds and surf destinations.
How was all that? What was the sort of reception of that?
Right.
Come on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool. What's one of the craziest thing that's happened with that?
Crazy.
Oh. That's my...
There'll be a lot
of vocabulary.
I can't think of any one specific one. That wasn't in the question, so I can't.
Sorry, off the script.
There was a lot of miraculous sort of things happened. Whether we'd be doing outreach and it was storms and suddenly it would clear over us, or there was no people right up to the time it started. Then you hear the bushes rustling, and people were crawling through the bushes. They got lost, and suddenly there's all people there. And yeah. So we did a lot. We had films from the Gospel Films Ministry.
Right.
Those big spools.
Yeah.
And we'd all be watching it, and then we'd hear this ticket, 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 and go, look on the ground, and there's all the film spools.
Oh, no.
We'd wrap it back up, get it back to them. Yeah. So we ran a lot of big films out in the
open air.
Open air with generators and bands. And
man, it's crazy. I never would have thought.
Yeah. We did have some interesting times. I can't pinpoint anyone in particular, but we ran surfing contests and at the time ran the biggest surfing contest in the world. It was a charity contest and we built orphanages and stuff out of the money of that. I don't know if it still stands to be the biggest one. But there was a lot involved because in every state and every there was up and down the coast there might have been like 50 different clubs. I mean, the Gold Coast was one that I actually became the national coordinator of Australia, so I visited all the clubs up and down, and that's how I met my wife, was visiting Sydney, Northern Beaches. I went to New Zealand.
Do you know
Anthony Walton?
I know the name.
Yeah, Wellington.
Okay.
Yeah, he did Christian Surfers in New Zealand. Yeah,
and there was guys before that.
Yeah.
That would have passed the baton on. I would have known
for sure.
Them. Yep.
Yeah.
Has it died off a bit now? The Christian Surfers Ministry, because I don't know of any on the coast that's thriving.
There is on the Gold Coast. There's a girls' group and there is guys, but
Nick Tetlow was leading it from beachside.
Nick was a young kid that used to come and stay with us at Phillip Island at the time. Yeah, and then so he was just a young grommet, what we call young grommet, and so I've known Nick all the way along there.
Yeah, no, he's fantastic.
That's cool. So that's how I was introduced to. Obviously, my grandfather's a pastor. Always has been. We used to go to church for Easter and sort of that. But my first sort of positive and something that I was interested in God experiences was with Christian surf guys, and it was just sick.
Yeah.
So that's I love the fact that that's just crazy. That's just bringing back memories for me. They'd take us down south. We'd go surfing. We'd hang out and pray, and just I was still smoking weed when I'd come back home and whatever. And they were just the coolest dudes to me. And they that's so cool. How that started.
Yeah, and we try to just be there for all the surfers, not to be a separate entity.
Yeah.
Like we needed to be integrated with them. And you take some brethren guys and do that. You got to re-educate them.
Yeah.
Because you start talking about doing any sort of evangelism or sharing their testimony, they didn't know what to say. So I had to actually re-educate them, teach them what they were actually. They didn't even know what they believed. Some of them. So it was really interesting.
So how long did this, were you sort of deep in that?
Probably 10 years,
wow.
Maybe.
That's amazing, yeah. Man. That's fantastic. I've seen hundreds, thousands of people, life changed with the gospel.
Yeah, yep.
That's awesome.
Yep. And today it's international in every country throughout the world, which I haven't had part of. So that was the other national coordinator who was, what happened is I went to Bible college for 3 years. And then when I came out of that, it was his turn to go.
Right.
So he was running it. And then when he went to college, I ran it.
Right.
And then when he came back out, I handed it back to him. It wasn't my cup of tea,
right,
as they say.
Right.
Yeah.
That's an old school
term. Oh, you loved it. Like,
I love surfing. I love and I loved
Jesus
visiting with the people. Yeah. I love visiting the people, but I wasn't really an organizational person.
Mm.
Yeah.
I'm not. That's not me.
No.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, that's cool.
Yeah, some people are, some people aren't.
Yeah, so and yeah, I wasn't into traveling the world to all these surf destinations. Like,
yeah,
I was more concerned about family.
So how did that come about? So you said you met Mel in Sydney.
Yeah, sure. Her story will differ.
Sure,
but
can't wait to hear.
Always does.
Do you want the mining version?
Yeah, I want your version.
So I was visiting an ex-champion surfer who was now Christian, running the Northern Beaches of Sydney's group at the time. And so I was staying with them, and then I went to their church that Sunday morning, because I often go to church with the local clubs. And we were getting some lunch to go home to their place for lunch. They're having some people over. And I walked into a milk bar with him to get some stuff to take back. I don't know, chickens and bread or whatever we're getting. And Mel was walking out. And she's eating an ice cream and has a big cheeky smile on her face and offers me some. And I thought, what sort of girl? This, Sydney's good. This is good. Yeah, it's like, it's not like Phillip Island. And I thought, when I saw her, I went, I pretty much almost like that presence I felt, it was like a voice saying, this is your wife. And I went, yes. That was almost like, wow. I can't say it was audible.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But it was like it was tangible.
Sensed it.
It was like it was tangible.
Wow. That's pretty cool.
And then when I got back out to the car, I said to my friend, who was the surfer, I said, wow, got to meet that girl again. He goes, yeah, she's coming to our place for lunch. So when I got there, there was no guys. There was like 10 girls. They'd set me up because I was a single guy and I was in my late 20s and they'd set me up with all these girls. Well, I must have seemed very rude because I just locked onto her. And it's like the other girls didn't exist and that's terrible. But
not when you only need one. Then, yeah. It's all good.
And then she knew that the penny had dropped in me and I made the connection on this one. And she ran for 2 years. She just ran away from me for 2 years. So she resisted.
Bit of wisdom in that.
She's Scottish. She's stubborn.
She didn't see the dots being joined either.
She could see them. She just was trying. She was trying to rub them out. But yeah. So that's how we met. Yeah.
Wow. Mm. And then so 2 years later, you're
dating.
Catch up again.
We
married
2 years later. Yeah. She
yields.
Found the truth. And I think we were going out for 2 weeks, maybe. And then we got engaged. And then we're married within, I think it was within 6 months. We're married. Yeah,
cool.
And I think the pastor of the church said, just, you know, as an example to everyone else, you might want to just leave a little bit of time. Otherwise, we're going to set a pattern here. So, but we knew. When she finally turned around, I mean, I'd known her for 2 years. We traveled overseas doing missions as a group and stuff like that with the church. And we'd been involved with stuff, but we were like opposing magnets. We'd be at a function or a party or something. And it's like wherever I walked, she was dodging me, and I was probably chasing her. It's a cat and mouse sort of thing. Yeah.
Wow, that's awesome. Mm. And then you're so you marry and move to Sydney?
I know we married in Sydney.
Yeah, married.
So I moved up from Phillip Island to Victoria.
Okay.
To Sydney.
Yeah, still sparking.
At that stage, I was in full time with the Christian Surfer still.
Yeah, okay.
And then I ended up going and getting a real job. And then ended up getting back into Sparky work, yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Wow. Cool. It's interesting you say, I know a little bit, you say you're not one to organise big things and all that, but you had a pretty big business in Sydney, didn't you?
We did, yeah. For about 14, 15 years.
Yeah.
We had I had a number of teams working for me.
Yeah, I'm not really good at organising.
Mm.
No, I wasn't.
Paid someone to do it.
We only got, you know, a few teams running around.
So I had apprentices and tradesmen. And we had worked for 12 builders. So we had, at any one time, we had new homes, renovations. And these are big ones on the waterfront, so they're big ones. And then also I had the service work where I ran around fixing things for people as well. So yeah, we're pretty busy. It was...
Oh, yeah.
I'd love to have that up here. That would have been great.
Sure.
Did you sell it?
No, you can't really sell it.
You need the contracts to be able to sell it.
You need contracts and it's more, it's the person they want. They want me.
Yeah.
So a number of my guys, I handed all the work to them. They said, I said, you can have the builders. But some of them just didn't know how to relate. So there's that connection you've got to have with the customers, with the builders. And there's that side of it. There's that personality side.
So you're in Sydney, married, running a, you know, business. You're still pursuing God, or
yeah. We were in a church there for 17 years.
Wow.
What were you doing while running? How much of your time were you giving to serving while you're running that business? Can't imagine you had a lot of time
serving. What's that? We ran. My wife seems to think that we didn't, but I'm pretty sure we ran an adults group, young adults group. That's how far back it is, but maybe my mind is playing games with me. But we did work with a lot of the young people and young adults in the church, so we had a lot of that. As far as serving,
by serving,
I just mean what were you doing in the community? Like, yeah, what were you doing with God and reaching out to His people and serving?
Fixing their electricity. I was pretty much locked into work. I had three kids, I had to work, and so we had no money, so I had to earn money, and get. That was the years of sort of trying to get ahead get somewhere. I was actually pretty blind doing it. I worked on high rises for a number of years, and Sydney went through a recession, or Australia did, and that must have been in the
90s.
It would have been, yeah. And I went out and worked for myself, and people thought I was mad. And then from the day I went out and worked for myself, I was never had a day off for years, for like 15 years. So apart from weekends, so I was constantly had work and just built up all these builders and stuff. So I was flat out doing that. Yeah, just to, and I didn't know what I was doing building a business, but I was doing it.
Wow. So and you're still like, and building as hungry for the Lord, still passionate about the Lord.
Yeah, I was always very, very passionate and hungry.
You still are, by the way. You still are.
Yeah. It probably more than ever.
Yeah, right. Okay. Is that because you're freer? Like, in the sense of responsibility?
Yeah, coming to chapel, we're freer.
No, in the sense of family responsibility and...
Well, we're almost empty nesters now. Yeah, we've got one more who's just about to leave home, so we're it's going to be pretty cool.
Yeah.
But, and I think you accumulate a lot of debts over those years with family and... We put them through private school, which was like painful.
Wow.
And so not for they loved it.
Yeah,
the girls loved it. My son, we had to put him in a public school because private schools couldn't cope. All those years of and the debt you accumulate, stuff like that. Yeah, we finally cleared a lot of that stuff.
Yeah, cool.
So it's been hard work, even at my age. All these years of working and making mistakes along the way.
Sure,
we've started things and businesses and made mistakes. What was your question?
Oh, just the sense of like you're still as passionate, pursuing God.
Yeah. So back then, back then you were saying, what was I doing back then? I was doing stuff in the church. We were part of what they call the young pastors. So there's older pastors, and they were sort of like apprenticing young guys.
Mm.
So we'd all be preaching and traveling and preaching and doing stuff like that, whatever we were skilled at. So that was my only thing I was doing.
Bringing up three kids.
Yeah, bringing up three kids.
Putting them through
private. I love doing it. But and then when we moved to the Gold Coast, the kids were hitting high school.
Yeah.
So that was another level of involvement. And then we got involved with the church. I always locked into churches. If we move anywhere, I make sure I lock in.
Community is important, right?
Yeah, and I just don't want to be out there as a sitting duck.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
Yeah. And so we'd get involved. And then, you know, we may move on in time and following our kids. I mean, the original church we're at when we came up, we moved on because our son ended up going to another church. He was out of church and went to a church, so we followed him.
Right.
That's another story. But I don't know where that gets us to now, Marshall.
That's okay.
I'm now... see, what happened was back in the early 80s, I had a number of significant... back in those days, you would call them elders, prophets, apostles. Big networks of churches would come and prophesy of us. I was an elder at the church in my early 20s at Phillip Island. and so they come in and lay hands on you and prophesy over you. And some pretty significant words were spoken over me, which somehow I've still got recorded. Now I've got them on my phone now, which is great. So I re-listened to those.
Wow.
And so they're prophecies that I don't think have happened yet.
Right.
And I don't think there is a time on them.
Right.
And so when I look at them, it's what God's doing in my life the whole way. So I've always felt a call to follow God. And even in the ups and downs, I forgot these prophecies for a while. And it was a number of years ago, God said, I want you to go back and get all the prophecies you've written down, recorded, and I want you to put it all together so you know and join the dots of what has been spoken over your life. And because I heard a pastor say this, that whenever he feels down or, you know, he carries them with him and he reads through his prophecies. This was Bill Johnson from Bethel. And I thought, wow, that's an interesting thought. So I actually got them. And it's really interesting when you go over your prophecies.
Yeah.
And either they're from God or they're not. And so, and you discern and weigh them up. And so that keeps me going too, because it's like Timothy.
Yeah.
Was also reminded to go back and remember what was gifted to him and spoken over him by
his mother elders and his grandmother
and the elders when they laid hands on him.
Mm.
And I'm like, that's interesting. So that sort of keeps me in check as well. But but there was a time when I was in a desert when I went out mining.
Literally in a desert or spiritually in a desert? Both.
So I'd sort of got out of the church. I was a bit bored with it. Mm. I hadn't got out of God, but
no.
And then my son and myself, we just joined the local board riding club and surf on Sundays. And so I got to know a lot of guys that way. And then I went out mining, and I think I was in a real desert time. I think God needed to take me out and just get me out and just speak to me. And then when I came back, I was refreshed, but it took a whole cycle of a number of years. Right. And then, of course, recently I've been out mining again, and that was a different experience again because I was really quite enjoying the presence of God while I was out there. But when I went out the first time for a couple of years, it was very dry. And I say that spiritually.
No, that's true. Yeah. You have to dig your own.
I think God had to just take me out a bit like Moses going out in the desert with the sheep and the goats or whatever it was.
Just graph your own well, as it were.
I had to just had to work through stuff and get some stuff out of me. Yeah.
Peter, it's man, this has gone so quick.
Mm.
This has been amazing.
Yeah. You might feel like we haven't answered some of those questions, but I think
in our
stories it's been way better.
Yeah.
So I just want to say you're a really important person. That's a part of our community. And I'm interested to see what those prophecies say.
Yeah.
And then I've got something I want to share with you once these mics are off. But, man, thanks so much. Thanks for making Chapel your home. Thanks for being faithful. Man, you're legit.
Yeah, thanks for your passion and, you know, your pursuit of the presence of God. And maybe just one thing maybe that's burning in your heart, just want to share before we...
My heart, it is all about presence.
Yeah.
Like nothing else matters. It's God's presence, and that's what drew me to Him.
Yeah.
And then, because if you try and do everything out of rules, or this is what should be done, it's not easy.
Yeah.
But if you do it out of sitting in His presence, living in His presence, working in His presence, your sport in your presence, wherever you are, if you're in His presence, it all becomes a lot more comfortable, easier, and the dots do join.
Yeah.
How for someone who hears that and doesn't understand that, how can someone get in His presence? Is it just is it trying to be aware of Him just in like?
I think you need to stop. First off, you need to stop.
Good.
And just wait. And that's a hard thing to do in this society where we're caught up doing stuff with social media and everything else.
Yeah.
Put the phone aside. Just go and sit somewhere at the beach and it'll drive you crazy for a while, but sit and feel, hear, see, sense, whatever God is speaking to you about.
Yeah.
I was lucky that I experienced that day on the hillside.
Yeah.
I felt His presence. But that hasn't been the whole way. I haven't mm. been able to live that the whole way. But more so in the last, maybe last decade.
Yeah,
cool. I've entered more into that.
Yeah.
But I would have gone in and out of that
sure.
in previous years and when I was doing stuff in the church and stuff. But that's another story.
Yeah. Oh, awesome.
That's awesome. That is a great way to end.
Thank you.
Thanks, mate.
Thank you.
Awesome.